Hello, everybody, and welcome to Seeds of Liberty podcast, episode 40. We're going to go with Jeremy for the BIPCOT NoGov license.
Yes, as always, the Seeds of Liberty podcast is covered by the BIPCOT No Government license. This allows for reuse by anyone except for governments and the agents thereof. You can find out more information about this at bipcot.org.
So today we have a very special guest, a super exclusive first interview with Anarchyball, never before seen on camera. Very exciting.
Hello. Hello.
All other interviews until ours. He just couldn't turn down the Seeds of Liberty podcast. So Anarchyball, thanks a lot for coming on the show.
Well, thank you. Nothing but the best for Anarchyball. That's what I always say.
See that? He surrounds himself with the bling bling already. So I love it. True capitalist. So, yeah, so your page is getting pretty big. I see you. You're growing it very nicely and got a lot of traffic. I'm very, very happy to see that. And the other Facebook pages are coming up slowly. I post
indeed.
On
the Agorist Ball. We're a growing family.
Yeah.
Lots of copycats out there.
Oh, of course, yes. Once they saw the success from Anarchyball, they just took off themselves, and so did we. So I think it's a win-win situation.
Yeah.
So were you the first of the Ball comic series?
No. Anarchy Ball is based off of the Country Ball series, which we are one of the least respected. They call us the Cancer Balls, oddly enough, because they're not supposed to be about political ideologies. They're only supposed to be about countries. So you make stupid jokes about countries and use the little flags in it, and that's what Country Ball started. Well, we decided to go with anarchism to teach people about anarchy using the same ball comic format while insulting the communists.
I've actually heard people that I've shared Anarchy Ball, post every so often, and like Stone Cold Statist are like, wow, that is hilarious and perfect and great. And man, I just love you guys.
Why, thank you. Thank you. We get a lot of different people from a lot of different areas putting themselves into the position of Anarchy Ball, which is kind of odd. You know, it's scenarios that we've all lived through, and all the people and statists and communists that have talked to us before have sort of influenced how we do things. And that's definitely where we come from is, you know, this stuff isn't completely made up. I mean, we do love to strawman the other Anarchy Balls, especially Ancom Ball. Everybody loves to hate Ancom Ball.
Oh, I hate Ancom Ball. I don't actually call ANCOMs. I call them communists because they're fucking communists. They're not. There's no anarchy in communism.
Well, no, of course not. But trying to convince them that would be an uphill battle with no win or no end in sight.
you gotta love the comms. They try hard. I wouldn't say I hate them though, because if it wasn't for them, I don't know if the Anarchy Ball series would be as funny. I mean, you can only pick on the U.S. ball so often, you know.
Absolutely, but one of the big problems we have is stocking enough of the Molotov cocktails to use in every one of our comics. It's insane. We run out of bottles all the time. You would think it would be easier than that.
My favorite Anarchy Ball comic that you appear in. Is the one where it shows your transformation from an ANCOM to an ANCAP by all of your ANCOM buddies taking your McDonald's paycheck.
Absolutely. Once people start to share, and then they start to share everything, and then one guy who makes more than everyone else shares more than everyone else, then it's just a downhill slide. I mean, obviously, we live in a society right now that is just trying to take as much as possible from the most productive people. And it's completely unsustainable. And I find that most people resonate with that message most of all when it comes to Anarchy Ball comics.
So let me ask you a question. Were you always Anarchy Ball, or did you start as a different ball and make your transformation to Anarchy Ball?
Well, I started as a see-through sphere, right? I was a clear sphere, and then somewhere along the lines, the yellow started to come in and the black when I realized how much bullshit that communism was spewing out.
So statist ball is just a clear nothingness, huh?
No. I didn't start as status ball. I mean, yeah, there's lots of representations of me, but I started out pure, one with the universe, absolutely transparent.
Oh, okay. Gotcha. And then the filthy ideology of anarchy got into there.
Beautiful, filthy anarchism and capitalism all over this thing. That's one of the reasons why I'm wearing the Santa hat. This is one of my favorite times of the year. I know most of the time people get sick of Christmas, but let's face it, this is capitalism right here.
I mean, I'm glad you took the anarchy ball. I'm glad an ANCAP took it, because we all know that anarcho-capitalism is the only true anarchy.
Well, absolutely. Now, I would say that the first anarchy, the black flag itself, would allow for any other group to join in. Now, the thing about anarcho-capitalism is it allows for productivity while still allowing other people to do what they want to do. It's so simple. It's A plus B equals C. If you want to be productive, you want to keep your own things. If anybody tries to take it away from you, they end up turning themselves into government. And that's the one thing I want to resist more than anything else is collectivism and theft.
Yeah, I'm not a big fan of forced collectivism and basically forced by, you know, fiat or bandwagon theft. It's just ridiculous.
Oh, absolutely. And it's even worse when you've got people doing it in the name of altruism. Like, I don't know how many times I've run into communists who have said that they want to take back the means of production violently. How in the hell could you possibly do anything altruistically when you're hurting people to get that done?
Well, you know, because of banana octopus.
Well,
yes, anarcho government.
Well, the ends justify the means in their eyes. I actually had one of them admit that to me the other day. They had to actually admit that, but they didn't see anything wrong with it. That's the scary thing.
That's very nihilistic.
Oh, no, of course.
When it came to that point of the conversation, it was like, so you're okay with using violence, because it wasn't even a matter of just, you know, trying to couch it as the initiation of aggression. Like, no, they were openly admitting that it was violence that they were willing to have somebody else use. And I said, you're fully willing to admit that, you know, you're okay with that as long as you get things that you want. And they, yeah, quite proud of themselves. And it was like, okay, moving on, because I don't know.
That's almost refreshing.
Yeah, well,
refreshing for a communist to actually admit it. I just want to hurt people to make society better.
Communism isn't the hero that we need; it's the hero we deserve.
Exactly. Yeah, it's like if you want to make an omelet, you got to break some eggs, right? So, isn't that the same argument that Hitler and every other dictator and tyrant made?
Exactly. Well, that's why I keep my ammo stocked. And I keep my guns well-oiled and well-maintained, because if they ever do get the balls, like me, to come after what they want, I'll be ready for them.
Man, I'm just so excited we have such a celebrity in the scene on the show. Like, I really don't even know what to say.
Thank you.
I mean, Anarchy Ball is the best. Every day, I mean, I look forward to Anarchy Ball more than any other page on Facebook or any other social media I'm on.
Wow, that's very incredible. Coming from a meme master such as yourself, that is very impressive.
I'm not a meme master. I only make really good Danilo memes. Okay.
yes, indeed.
Yes. Yes, don't forget hashtag Danilo memes. Look Dave, for it out there, folks.
Dave is the Yoda of memes, right?
No, there's people all out there
that
make memes.
All I know
is
that they'll never
silly.
Take my memes of production.
Right.
Oh, me, the memes of production. Is that a page yet? Because that
it is actually. If you look up my big fat balls, it's a page that we made for the fans, and basically you use the memes that we put out there for everybody so that you can, you know, make your own comics. Communist,
No. Fascist, is there a page called anybody. Memes of Production? Is that what that page is called?
Oh, no. It's not called Memes of Production. It's just a page for everybody to put out their comics. I enjoy all forms of
see Anarchy Ball. You're not thinking. You're not thinking clearly. We need to go seize the page, Memes of Production, and start putting out communist propaganda. And then once that page gets to about 10,000 likes, we flip the script on them.
Interesting. That's very nice.
You gotta strategize here, okay?
Strategic skullduggery.
Yes.
Well, yeah. It's like state capitalism, you know. If at first you can't blame communism or capitalism, try again. You know, the communists blame the capitalists for why things were so bad in their country, so they abolish capitalism, they get more problems, and then once it finally collapses, they call it state capitalism instead of communism. I love that cycle.
Oh yeah, oh that wasn't communism, that was state capitalism. I'm like, state capitalism is called fascism. Communism always gets co-opted by fascist.
Dictionaries are important. Gotta define basic terminology here. It's always helpful to dispel myths. You know, any kind of I think you do that a lot, Jeremy, right? You're like, wait, what are you talking about? Define your words, and then we'll go from there.
Well, you have to ask, and usually, you know, a lot of the self-proclaimed ANCOMs I come across are the first ones who don't want to define their terms. They just want to assume whatever they made their original, whatever they assumed it was the first time. They're just going to stick with that no matter what, and not actually tell you, and just keep going.
They're so pedantic, soft. It's just you just hate the poor.
I don't know. In fairness, you know, I hear a lot of ANCAPs making the same argument for capitalism, which is true as far as I can see, that, you know, it actually hasn't, you know, free market capitalism hasn't been given the opportunity to flourish because the state's always been in the way in some capacity. So when people say, you know, well, when they say, oh, capitalism always fails, well, no, capitalism doesn't be tried. They are making the same argument, because technically, if it's supposed to be that whole use the state to free yourself of the state that Marx promised, you know, that whole do this, utopia. If that was to be believed, then yes, technically it hasn't happened yet. It just seems to have a funny way of when the state gets a hold of it, that somebody really nasty gets to the top and they never get to that using the state to get rid of the state. Doesn't actually
ever
happen.
Well, with all communism and leftism in general, you find that the first victim of their agenda is mathematics. They can't ever figure out exactly how to distribute everything evenly over an entire country full of people.
Right.
Well, that and how corrupted they get, you know, it's so silly. You know, the United States is a very corrupted country, but I mean, all countries and governments tend to get corrupted, but it happens so rapidly in communist countries, it's hilarious.
Yeah, it's a basic economic calculation problem, right? You know, when the state takes control of food, for example, they have no idea what to charge, you know, how much bread costs, you know, production and transportation, and, you know, they have no idea. And so you have either shortages or surpluses, and either way, you know, people starve and die.
Yep.
And then they blame, you know what? You see, thank God for the government to give us the bread. How would we get bread without the government, right?
Oh, yeah.
Well, if you look at the recent election down in Venezuela, you'll find that the people understand this trick. The entire platform of Maduro was basically to blame capitalism for everything that he did wrong in that country. And it didn't work. It backfired. And you saw all the people sort of, you know, push it aside and say, we're done with this. We need some sort of economic freedom.
Yeah, Venezuela is sitting on the world's largest oil reserve. Everyone in Venezuela should be have a mansion with three cars and full pantries, but it's not happening.
Yeah,
it's the perfect example that even with all the resources in the world, communism still cannot succeed. There will never be any post-scarcity for a communist society. It just doesn't work.
Well, yeah. Oh, sorry, go ahead, Danilo.
No, you go ahead.
Oh, I was just gonna say that yeah, that does seem to be the problem. I mean, Dave mentioned it earlier on the larger scale, it never seems to work. On a smaller scale, you know, I don't have. That's why I gave up on picking on a lot of the ANCOMs, because, you know, if you want to have your own little commune, go for it. I think it'll work. But on a larger scale, it does seem to fail miserably, because exactly what you guys are saying with the you know, the calculation issues, and you know. What are they going to do? They have no choice. That eventually the people are going to get fed up, but the problem is, how long will that last? Because what was it before Maduro? I mean, there, Chavez was there for what? So it was like 15 years of this.
Exactly.
You know, and yeah, now people are finally fed up. But what did they do? They want control of the government rather than just getting rid of the damn problem. So they obviously,
and that's. The only real winner in this election is the toilet paper industry, because now people will be able to buy toilet paper instead of waiting in 4 or 5 day long lines to get it.
That's ridiculous.
So the people haven't really won their independence from government as much as they have won the right to wipe their asses. Yay, statism.
Yeah. Well, it's basically a little reprieve, you know. That's the whole it's the same cycle you see here, just not as severe, because, you know, it's been a slow plod towards complete tyranny since pretty much the beginning. And every once in a while, when the people look back and they point to their, you know, supposed liberty loving heroes and go, well, see here, this person did this. It's like, yeah, if any liberty or freedom of any kind was restored, it was like this little blip in the line, and then it just goes back to the constant of you know, of the pressure. And so, like I said, it's great that people get fed up, but I almost hate to guess how long it'll be before they fall right back into that again. Because usually what tends to happen in a lot of these countries around the world is when people finally get fed up enough and they toss it off, because they're not prepared to handle the actual responsibility, they get, you know, some of the remnants of the old regime, or people who thought like that, end up re-entering, and just, you know, switching sides for the time being, and then convincing everybody that no, we can still do certain things, and then it just eventually people become used to it again, and the whole cycle starts over again.
Well, I've always seen the state as being doomed to its own success. For instance, if the state were to lower taxes and to increase economic freedom across the board, decreasing all of the regulations and all of the restrictions on the free market, what you would find is that the government would get a lot richer a lot quicker, causing it to think that it deserves to exist, basically increasing its power, increasing its size, and destroying itself once again. So if you take a look at the success of a state as being its ultimate downfall, you'll see that it is unsustainable to the core.
Yeah, that's one thing that I really took from reading Rothbard and Anatomy of the State, is that you know it's like people think, you know, what came first? Is it you know, prosperity or government? And what's the relationship, right? And basically, in order to have a government which is a parasite on the industrious, you first have to have a prosperous society for the parasites to come and siphon off the productivity.
Yep.
Right?
Yep.
So prosperity always must precede government, the formation of a government.
Yeah.
Well, it's getting even more confusing nowadays, because basically governments around the world operate with funds from other governments, and they're just printing their own money to such an extent and pushing it off onto greater and greater numbers of people, you don't even see the inflation anymore. It's almost as if they're trying to tie everybody to the same stone that will eventually drag us all to the bottom.
Well, yeah, I think now the Federal Reserve is printing so much money, but, you know, we don't feel it for various reasons, right? Number one, we can export the inflation, right, to other countries, since we have the World Reserve currency, as well as the fact that a lot of that printed money or digital money is being parked at the major banks, and they're being paid interest for not loaning out the money. And so once all that
all that crap toilet paper. You know, when you mentioned toilet paper, I first thought of currency. All that toilet paper from other people, they're realizing what a bad bargain they get, and they're going to use it to buy up American, you know, real goods. All that's going to flood back in. We're going to see huge amounts of inflation. And then not to mention, once the banks release those funds and start, you know, putting into the general circulation, you're gonna see major inflation. But people don't, you know, people are confused. Since 2008, they've been printing massive amounts, but we haven't seen inflation. It's kind of confusing. Prices have been going down, right? Gas
have you,
and
have you seen
metals and commodities?
Have you seen the Fed since its inception had an inflation like rate, like a line that was following, and then it just goes whew.
After 71.
No, after 2000. From 2000 until now, they printed enough to hit 800 years of the if inflation hadn't changed before then.
Oh, right. Yeah, I remember reading a statistic from 2006, like the whole time Ben Bernanke was at the helm of the Federal Reserve.
Correct, yeah.
He printed like double the amount of currency since the United States started.
Yeah.
Something like that.
Yeah.
Right.
And
Yellen's going to be even worse, right? Many magnitudes worse, just like every Fed chairman is worse than the previous in terms of, you know, quantitative easing.
Yeah, well, it's but that's the whole thing, that people don't recognize that. I mean, what you said, Danilo, about printing, or, you know, like the digital printing of money, most people are under the impression that, yeah, sure, they can just print more money. What's the big deal?
Right. That's like,
you know, so many people don't even understand the basic concept of what money actually is, versus what a currency is, and what we actually have, you know, what is actually in your pocket and what it's actually worth. I mean, we've discussed it a bunch of times before, but I wasn't immune to this. That's, you know, I way back when I thought the same thing. Oh, they just print it. Like, you know, the first time they ever had the first time I ever remember hearing about some kind of stimulus. I don't know. Did Clinton do one? Maybe I can't remember. It was a while ago.
No.
No, it was there was definitely
he did NAFTA.
There was somebody who did one at some point, and I just remember getting the check and just being, all right, great, yeah, free money. And,
yeah, you know, yeah, I remember that. I think that was that Obama? I think that no, I think
that was Bush. That was Bush. Bush. Yeah, that was right before that was his last.
Yeah,
that was his last
everybody
year.
It's a tax rebate.
Yeah. Right. I mean, it's just like all right. It's like you don't even question it. It's just, you know,
free money.
Exactly, free money. Where's it come? Who cares? It's free. I can buy things, right?
That's... We're starting to sound like Bernie Sanders supporters now. Free stuff.
Ah, yes. Feel the burn. Feel the burn, ladies and gentlemen.
So what's your thoughts on Bernie there, AB?
Bernie Sanders, I think, should stick to making dank memes and not to making economic policies. I think the memes that have come out of Bernie Sanders' movement is far superior to anything he would ever do as president.
Well, you can tell that Bernie's rattling up the Democrats. They're putting the debates on like Saturdays at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. They're not doing it in prime time on CNN, you know.
Oh, such a grassroots revival right there. He's just pulling out the base.
Oh yeah. No. Like, they're doing that for a reason. They don't want him to upstage Hillary. They want everybody to go, I didn't even see the debates.
Well, that's a big part of it. I think he won't stand up against Hillary. There's no way that he will. He knows about Vince Foster. He knows about all the bodies down there in Arkansas. There's no way that he would want to join them. That's ridiculous. He knows who the Mafia Don is.
You know, one of my favorite Bernie Sanders memes I saw recently was him sitting at a computer. And you see a picture of a, you know, economics for dummies textbook. He's like, he's goddamn libertarian.
Sent him that. I actually said that.
Why is goddamn libertarian sending me this stuff? I cracked up. So
yeah, it's funny.
Good.
I don't know if you guys saw this or not, but this was in the Washington Post a few days ago. They started marking all the Bernie Sanders campaign literature that they would send out in the mail as spam. Because of all of the promises that they made. This is a real story, too.
Free iPad for everybody.
Wow.
That's right.
I had actually heard
free
something.
Free college.
I had actually heard something about that it was.
Yeah, I read that. That's what that was.
Upset.
I think you can tell the Bernie Sanders supporters when you hear those people that click on those free iPad, you know, and Facebook, you see the ads on the sidebar, you know, that's the Bernie Sanders supporters.
Ah, yes. Like our most famous meme of all times, where the inbreds are holding up a sign that says, "Capitalism has crashed. Start over with another system." And Anarchyball says, "That's because you inbreds keep clicking on every ad that says free iPads."
Yeah, I love that meme.
I remember that one.
I love that meme. That thing's killer right there. I know exactly which one you're talking about.
Well, again, sadly, I remember that mindset because it wasn't all that long ago that I still thought like that.
Yeah, that's why we have to have patience, because I think a lot of us thought like that, and it's hard to not laugh at people that still genuinely think like that.
Right? So is there a Mrs. Anarchyball, or is there, I mean, are you just a solo dolo kind of guy?
Well, I usually keep my love life secret, but there are several Mrs. Anarchyballs, and they do.
Several? Wait a minute, are you a Mormon? I'm confused.
Some people compare ball morality to Mormonism, but it's very different.
You gotta catch them all.
We don't wear any underwear at all.
You gotta catch them all, you know.
That's right.
So,
this is getting dangerous now. No underwear.
Oh me.
Oh.
So,
Lady Anarchy Ball, she wears a bow. So if you ever need to know the difference, it's the bow.
Scantily clad. Nice.
Very, very scantily clad. Indeed.
Yeah, I saw that before and was thinking, wow, where's her burqa?
It's very offensive. Yes. I haven't received any of the sexual harassment complaints yet, but when they realize that I'm sitting here naked, surrounded by money, wearing only a hat, I'm sure that we will receive the complaints.
You are talking about the same generations of people that never realized that Donald Duck never wore pants, but he wrapped a towel around himself when he got out of the shower. So I don't know if they'll actually catch on to that one.
That's hilarious. Yeah. Oh me. So Anarchyball, are you trying to take over the world with your funny memes and comics, or what's the plan here?
I would never presume to take over anything. If people like my comics and they like what I do, by all means, share them and make some of your own. But you'll never take my memes of production. Those are mine. I made those. Those are mine. Thank you.
Oh me. Who's your pick to win president this year, or next year rather?
Next year, I personally I haven't been following too closely anything. I find that much like the Japanese animes that cause seizures, whenever I look at Trump's hair, I go into violent seizures, flopping on the floor. It's disgusting.
Rolling on the floor. I got you.
Oh yes. So
Anarchyball, what's your view on incrementalism? Do you think we should elect Iran to slowly transition into voluntarist society?
For the most part, I am completely opposed to the idea that somehow just the tip will get us to pull out. I don't think government has never worked that way. I don't think it will ever start working that way. And much the same as fucking for virginity, I think that pulling a little bit out at a time is just as pointless.
The just a tip is how I got my two kids. So.
There you go. The truth.
Look what hashtag Danilo memes has unleashed with Danilo. Now he's actually getting raunchy on the
air. Oh, Lord. Oh, I've got I've got that meme juices flowing.
What have you done, Dave?
Oh, the meme juices are flowing. I can't wait to get on my phone.
I mean, obviously, I agree with you, obviously, AB, about, you know, the incrementalism thing just not necessarily being worth the time. I would ask more, though, you know, we mentioned, you know, Anarchyball earlier, and you know how everybody likes to poke fun on at them, and because, well, it is so easy. But is there any actual real, you know, disdain between any of the balls? Do you, is like any of them that really gets under your skin in particular, or do you actually just kind of laugh along at all the rest of them?
Well, as you've noticed, I haven't moved from the spot the entire interview because there's mutualism ball somewhere in this apartment, and I find whenever I move, he automatically jumps in there because I wasn't using it at the time.
What about nihilism ball? I'm pretty sure.
Well, nihilism ball generally keeps to himself. He doesn't like to come out and play unless you insult nihilism. He comes out and starts screaming about Nihil Akbar for some strange reason. I have never seen anyone defend nothingness as much as he defends nothingness.
Right.
Oh, me. Right. Oh, me. Nihilist ball, man. He gets upset. I heard he's attending a university.
Ah, yes. Yes, the university that we dare not speak its name. I got reported for attending this university and for seeing how things were working there. And I think I'm still on ban right now. I'll be on ban for another 12 hours or so. It's a nice vacation. As you can see, I'm relaxing on my little Facebook hiatus right here, sitting with my coins and counting them. But no, I find that when you offend a certain number of people, it always ends up turning out like this. I call it Cantwell's Law. Right? If you hate a group of people so much that you are willing to sacrifice your principles to hurt that group of people, you will end up turning into the group of people that you hate. And with this nihilism situation, they hate moralists so much that they are willing to turn themselves into censorship moralists to try to take them out of the situation. Much like Kitwell and his hatred of crybullies. He hates crybullies so much, he's turning into one.
Oh, yeah. Wow. I didn't think it. Yeah.
Well, I forgot all about them. I thought it was just a leftist that, you know, he openly advocated using the state to crush. That's a whole nother issue. But yeah.
Oh, yeah. He's all about using the state to crush the leftist, to crush the immigrants, to get them out of there. Because if you don't act, someone has to do something. And I find that's the most dangerous phrase in the history of mankind. Someone has to do something. It's like,
no, besides that, I'm from the government. I'm here to help, man.
Exactly.
All right.
Well, that statement comes because of the first.
Right.
Yes.
If you were trapped in an elevator with White House ball and Federal Reserve ball, and you had a gun with only one bullet in it, which one would you shoot?
Well, that's difficult.
Yourself.
Yeah. At that point, I would go the honorable route and take myself out because
no hope.
I wouldn't want to have
that's democracy
that
in action.
Blood
that's
on gang. My hands.
That's majority.
I can imagine shooting one of them would turn out like the Aliens movies with the acidic blood spraying out and destroying everybody in its path. And I think mostly that's what revolution is. You shoot the alien, and then the acid eats through your ship, and then you die. And that's basically what a violent revolution does. You try to get rid of the enemy, and the enemy ends up getting rid of you.
So let me ask you. I see you adorn yourself with some beautiful coins. So what's your view on precious metals and what role they may play in our future?
Ah, yes. Precious metals have always existed in society and in civilization as a means of storing wealth and trading wealth. And I think they may not have intrinsic value, but I think having them on hand just in case anything happens, you can trade and continue storing wealth instead of having it wiped out digitally with whatever may happen with the internet or how things have gone with the regular currency. I mean, let's face it, you could have $100 million in a wheelbarrow, and it'll be worth just as much of nothing as if it was just blank paper. So, I believe precious metals have always been a very valuable store of wealth, and that's just how it's gone.
So if Russia goes to a gold backed currency, are you applying for citizenship there?
I would rather go to Anarchadia than Russia. I think people have forgotten that Putin was a KGB agent, very high level, and anything he appears to be is probably just a trick and probably just, you know, his masterful skill using PR. I haven't really seen any of the free market that that was promised with the association.
Russia's Putin. Russia's economy was on a rise until these sanctions, and they just legalized ownership of guns for it's not an amendment or anything. They just legalized gun ownership for self-protection, which hadn't happened since the Bolshevik Revolution.
Well, that's what they say.
Well, that's a very positive step, yeah. But at the same time.
Yeah, well, I think that's what you were just, I think that's what all over there was just saying. about his ability with PR and stuff. Like, I don't know, do you know anybody in Russia? Have they actually been able to get guns, or is that just something that people are being told? So, you know, I don't know.
Precisely, yeah.
I mean, it could be just some bullshit I read. I mean,
No. I heard similar stories, and it's being, as far as I understood it, it was being presented as a fact. But, you know,
Russia had the worst crime rate in all of European countries, I think. Which, I mean, crime rate is, it only matters what they report, really. Like,
well, I was gonna say, yeah, those type of statistics are meaningless in actual discussions, because you have no, you know, you have to see breakdowns to be able to understand what any of it actually means. That's like the whole all the numbers that get tossed around over here about gun deaths and all this, you know, everything gets lumped together. Nobody has any idea what they're talking about.
For sure.
So
what's your favorite book?
I hate to do this, but I think it's time for me to get going. I've got other responsibilities. I've got memes to make and hearts to break. So I need to be heading out now.
Oh, all right. Well.
All right. Well, thank you so much for coming on Anarchy Ball. I know your time is very valuable, and you've been a great guest, and you're welcome back on anytime you want. Keep doing what you're doing. We're proud of you, and tell everyone where they can reach you.
All right, you can reach me at anarchyball.com if you would like to purchase any of our fabulous merchandise. And you can also check us out on Facebook, Twitter, Reddit, and basically everywhere you could possibly go. We are already there. Do not try to run. You will be assimilated. Anarchy Ball is coming for you. Ta-ta.
Nice. Thank you.
All right, Anarchy Ball. Nice meeting you. All right, so wonderful guest there, had to run, had some food there, so good to have him on.
Wow, that was interesting. I was when Dave told us that we were going to have a special exclusive guest, I could definitely, I was not see that one coming.
That was a lot of laughs, man. That was funny.
Glad he was able to fit us into his busy schedule. That was, that was nice.
I go check out mine and Danilo's interview from a few weeks ago. It just got released. If you're listening to this, go check it out. It was pretty cool.
Yes, and I just listened to it today. It was.
What'd you think?
It was good.
It's good. Okay.
All right. Now tell me what you really think.
Oh, come on, we're still recording. I wouldn't do that.
Well, tell me all
that kind of language online. Come on.
Well, I'm down to wrap up as well. I like a good short show. This way we go 45 minutes. That'd be awesome. Yeah.
Yeah, Dave's not feeling well, so we should probably cut it short.
I feel like doo doo.
So. All right. So. Wonderful show, guys. Thank you very much, everyone, for watching. If you want to donate to us, we accept Patreon and Bitcoin. Please help us out. We love doing this. It's a labor of love, but any monetary encouragement would be much appreciated. Please like, comment, share, and subscribe. You can help us spread the message of freedom and liberty.
Yes. So,
thank you, everybody. This is the Seeds of Liberty podcast, wishing everyone have a wonderful day. Take care. Bye.
Peace.